everybody. Welcome back to my YouTube channel. My name is Becca, if we have never met before, and this is my channel where I talk about all the houseplant things. Today we are going to be looking at one of my old Better Home and Gardens gardening books and just seeing what sort of advice they give in this book and seeing how relevant it is today, or maybe if I follow this advice today. I did buy this book a while ago because I am very, very interested in Better Home and Gardens like vintage cookbooks because I happen to inherit, I think, 4 or 5 of them that have been in my family. The oldest one in the collection was published in 1946, so I think that is just so cool. I actually used them to write one of the biggest research papers of my entire college career, so it was very, very cool. I've definitely scanned those cookbooks up and down. I've read them almost cover to cover to use in this project. So I wanted to look at this one and kind of look at it through the same glass. It won't be the same topic because this is not a research paper. Without further ado, let's just open up this book. So I see here that it was published in 1951 in Des Moines, Iowa. So a lot of the Better Home and Gardens books were published in Iowa, and specifically Des Moines, Iowa. So I wonder if that is like their headquarters or something like that. This is a little bit of a geeky moment because does anybody actually look at this information in their books? Because I know that I do. Like in every single book I ever buy, I always look at the date it was published and like the city and the company. Something that I did in my research paper, and a big, big part of the research paper, was looking at the foreword and basically like the dedication of the cookbooks to see who the general audience the book was trying to reach. And so in a lot of these sort of garden books, they are for the homemakers of the world and the grandmas and moms and just people who are cooking for their families, and in this case, gardening for themselves, hopefully. So I'm going to just briefly skim over this foreword really quick. This book is offered as a guide, counselor, and aid to new homeowners eager to start planting. It is for you whose interests and family needs have changed since your property was new, and you who simply want to keep your place looking well. So there are 3 target audiences in this book. 1, the new homeowner. 2, the maybe empty nester. I feel like that's what it's trying to say. And then 3, someone who just wants to make their home look really nice. So those are 3 really great reasons to start owning plants. I mean, I started owning plants because of a big change in my life, so I guess that might correspond with things have changed since your property was new. Things have changed for me, so that is probably why I own houseplants. To all, I'd like to say that the rewards of gardening and of the garden handyman's work are as pleasantly surprising as they are varied. You won't become a gardener just by reading this book. You will get ideas, you will get inspiration and help. You will see how to do things better and more easily, things that led to a full and enjoyable life at home. No one is too young or too old to start. I love that. That is so beautifully written. Oh my gosh, that is so beautiful. I love that it says that you're not going to learn everything from this book, and that a lot of what you will learn, it will come from your own experience, and also that no one is ever too old or too young to get into gardening. And as it talks about gardening, I'm kind of just reframing that into indoor gardening because I personally don't have the capacity or the space to do any sort of outdoor gardening. So this is really nice to, I don't know, just see. And I'm even more thankful that I have this book now that I'm actually having the chance to read it, because I know that there's going to be a lot of really great information about gardening. But there is an entire section for houseplants, and that's what we'll be looking at today. So we have our table of contents, trusty table of contents. So let's find houseplants. Window gardening and success with houseplants. So that's a good one. Control of pests and disease. That would probably be pretty relevant as well. And seed starting. I'm working on a seed starting project, and I just bought like a bunch of little cells to grow the seeds. So I will probably be also referring to chapter 18, seed starting, for that, because I don't know much about seed starting and I would like to learn more. It's just that there's not a lot of stuff out there for seed starting houseplants, which is what I'm doing. So I'm interested to see, you know, how it differs, or even if it's even just the same thing, because at the end of the day, a plant is a plant, you know, whether it grows outside or it grows inside, it's still a plant. So let's start with window gardening and success with houseplants. We have window gardening, bulbs, amaryllis, caladiums, all of those sorts of things. Gift plants. That's a good one. House plants as decoration, window gardening, decorative plants for spots that lack sun. I'm very interested to see that part. African violets, geraniums, coleus, bloodleaf, begonias, garden flowers for the indoor bloom, and small home greenhouse. Oh, that's really interesting. And also succulents. So there are a few topics in here that seem relevant to me and what I'm doing in my life right now. So I'm very interested to see what we have here. And I just want to say, I absolutely love the photos that are in these books and the drawings. I mean, it's just so beautiful. I get emotional thinking about how much work goes into these. Just these sorts of books in general, like even up to today, there is so much work that goes into them. And it's just beautiful. I would love to design a spread for a book like this. That would be so much fun. Window gardening aids. So wick watering, we have a little note on wick watering. We have a note on repotting, so removing the plant from its previous pot. So it suggests that you allow the soil to become slightly dry. That is very true. That's a really great tip. And then spread your fingers across the pot top, holding the plant with stem between index and middle finger, right here. Invert and tap rim of pot on a table or edge or other firm object. Oh, that's a really, really great tip. I never, ever, ever thought to tap it on something, but that is such a good idea. Comment down below if you do that or if you've ever heard of that, because that's really awesome. Okay, and then we have some soil mixtures for some different types of plants. I would absolutely love for a window in my house to look like this. I'm not like super, super into flowering plants, but I think that it would be nice. Like someday when I have a house big enough to do this, it would be really nice to have just one room or just at least one windowsill dedicated to look like this. Because currently in my house, I have 3 east-facing windows and 2 west-facing windows, so 5 windows total. And all of those windows, if I can, there's plants in them. So there's just not a lot of space to do something like this. And I'm just like itching to get into a bigger house so that I can like spread out and like just do more, which is so funny because my last place was like the size of this room that I'm in right now, and I managed to fit a lot of plants in there too. So I think that it's really easy to be discontent with your space. I definitely feel that all the time. I always feel like my place is too small. But I would just really like more windows so that I can do stuff like this because that is so beautiful. And I love these shallow terracotta pots in these saucers that look like super shallow terracotta pots. I love those saucers. Those are really cute. That just looks like really visually nice. Okay, so it says here, most houseplants are tolerant and grown equally well in east, south, or west windows. Tending them requires only a few minutes daily. Small cost for big return. I agree completely, and I did notice that they completely left out the mention of a north-facing window, and if you are in the southern hemisphere, that would be your southern-facing windows, so I think that's really interesting that they just don't even mention a north-facing window because honestly, they're kind of irrelevant with houseplants. I used to have a really big north-facing window in my last place, and my plants were doing okay, but they were just kind of stagnant for almost a year living there. So I'm really glad that I'm not in that situation anymore. I keep referring to my paper that I wrote in college, but basically the paper was about how women are portrayed in cookbooks through the ages. And I really focused on the 1950s to 1990s era in that paper. And so looking at this, it's very, very interesting that this is a man that is gardening flower bulbs. I've never seen that before. The only time that I see men in the cookbooks would be when it was like grilling or when the food was being prepared. Like if there was an illustration of the woman like bringing the food to the table, it would be a photo of the man and his son just kind of sitting there like with their utensils in their hands like this. So I think that's really interesting that he is, well, number one, he has a pipe in his mouth. But number two, that there is even a man in the gardening section. I think that's very interesting and probably pretty progressive, honestly. So we have some caladiums. Those are really beautiful. And some calla lilies. Those are really nice too. I think that of all the plants here, I would be most interested in caladiums. I've never ever had one before. The foliage is super, super striking, so that would be really nice. But as far as like regular growth goes, I'm not really interested in that kind of stuff. I'm much more interested in foliage plants. So this is a page of just basic plant care for a couple of different plants. So I'm not familiar with really any of these. Like begonias, needs position out of drafts and good light. In my experience with the one begonia that I have, that is very true. They need a lot of light, especially the one that I have. I think it's a Begonia lucerna. It just likes super bright light and it does super, super well in that, but not too hot. It does not like the heat at all. I had it outside for a while and it almost died, and then I brought it inside and it just like blew up. Poinsettias in here. Lots of really awesome stuff. And again, this photo, it's so cool. I think that this actually is a photo. I don't think that it's a drawing, but I just love the way that this looks. It's so cool. And I see a lot of like familiar plants in here. Houseplants as decorations. Okay, so let's look at some plants here. It's a little bit harder to ID these in black and white. So I'm definitely like, I feel lucky that all of the photos I've seen of plants so far have been in color, because I feel like that really helps you to see a lot easier like what is going on with the plant or even what kind of plant it is. It looks like ivy. Oh yeah, okay, so we have Sylvanian Beauty Ivy. Okay, so we also suggested a Dracaena. Dracaena is really great. Those will live through anything, I mean, honestly. And then we have Philodendron. This looks like just regular heartleaf Philodendron. And it also suggests to use Philodendron sprays in green peperomia next handles of twin mugs for rumpus room wall. That's a really great idea. So it's suggesting to hang mugs on your wall with a hook and put your plants on them. So that's a really great idea. I love that. If I could ever find, like, that would be really cute in the kitchen, you know what I mean? Because like kitchen mugs, the whole theme, it would just work really well. We have a Chinese evergreen or an aglaonema, which is a really great idea. It is in a king size cup and saucer on a wooden base serving as a bookend. That's a really great idea, a really great use of space. These are all in cups and mugs, so they obviously haven't drilled drainage in any of this. So they are suggesting things that don't have drainage. As I see, there's a mug here, a teacup here. And then we have a piece of ivy that is living in an old glass lamp. Oh my goodness, that's a really great idea. It's just like, it's basically a plant that lives in water full time, except it's displayed in this really beautiful glass. That's really nice. I really, really like that. And then we have ideas for window gardening. So we have twin plant stands. That's really nice. See if we can recognize. There's the Diffenbachia, some spider plants. We can see the little babies there. Tabletop gardening. There's a Lazy Susan or a library step table. A Lazy Susan is a really, really great idea. That's just like the round piece of wood or whatever that spins. That's a really great idea. And then radiator tops. Oh my gosh, it's suggesting an aquarium. That is so cool. So it's suggesting that you put an aquarium on top of a radiator, and you can grow plants in that. That is a really, really cool idea. It's kind of like the idea of those like closed terrariums that are a little bit bigger. A vivarium, I think it's called. So this is like the vivarium before they were trendy, and they're just now getting trendy. And then we have the strictly modern look, which is much more minimal, and that chair is so beautiful. I need that chair in my life. All right, another beautiful photo. Oh my gosh, look at these African violets down here. The African violet was actually my great grandma's favorite plant, and I tried to have one in her honor, and I kept it for a long time, but I was so frustrated that it didn't bloom again for me that I just gave it away because I'm not patient enough for flowers. Decorative plants for spots that lack sunlight. So this is the part that I was really interested in looking at. So we have ferns, Dracaena, and then the two philodendrons, the cut leaf and the smaller, more familiar form, are with Diffenbachia, Sansevieria, and fiddleleaf rubber tree, the most adaptable of houseplants when they get little or practically no direct sunlight. Oh, no. No. That is so, so interesting. So this little section here is suggesting that fiddleleaf figs, rubber trees, and a Monstera deliciosa like low light. Like it says here, practically no direct sun. That is so interesting. I think I'm thinking that they said that because this book is written from maybe a gardener's perspective. So from a gardener's perspective, living outside, or plants living outside, it's either like full sun, partial sun, or no direct sun. So maybe that's what they're referring to. And they're bringing that back inside. So they're saying that these plants don't like full sun. I feel like that's what they're trying to say here. Like if you are a gardener looking at this, you might think, oh yeah, it needs what we would call medium light, which I would say that a fiddle-leaf fig needs a lot more than medium light. I would venture to say that a fiddle-leaf fig needs direct sunlight for a couple hours, but that's very interesting that they're suggesting that. I do see down here the heartleaf philodendron. That is a plant that could live with little to no direct sun. I think the direct sun thing is throwing me off because maybe this is correct advice. It's just that the verbiage is off from what we know today as being the correct verbiage. This arrow is referring to this photo. So it says, when you have no sunny windows to a lot solely to houseplants, put your plants on a wheeled cart. If you wheel your indoor garden into the sun for an hour or two each day, most houseplants will flourish. I have heard of people doing that, like moving their plants into sun like for a part of the day. That just seems like a lot of work to do like all the time. But I guess if you have a cute little cart with all these little flowers, that might be really nice. We have an entire section of African violets here, which is really, really cool. It suggests that you place the plant on saucers filled with pebbles and water. So that's really interesting that the pebble tray is being suggested in the 1940s or whatever. That's super cool because I have a pebble tray right now. So wow, we have propagation of African violets. I'm not going to go through all of this because I feel like not a lot of us are interested in African violets. But we have begonias. Look at this beautiful begonia. I'm not super into begonias. As I said before, I only have one. So this is the angel wing begonia, which is one that I would actually really like to have. And it says here, the silver dotted leaves of the angel wing begonia are especially handsome when set off by a plain background and the plant is kept where all its leaves tilt towards the light. I think that's true for a lot of plants. It's really nice when all of the leaves are facing one direction. I struggle with that a lot with my plants because I have them facing the windows. And so what the plants do is all of the leaves will face the windows and I can't see them. So yeah, I guess I would really like for my plants to all face me, but it makes sense that they want to face the light because plants follow the light. Okay, so we have gardening for indoor blooms. We have lots of really beautiful indoor blooms. I did not know that you could grow these sorts of things indoors, to be completely honest with you. But it suggests a few things. If you might be interested in indoor blooms as well, the suggestions that it gives is stocky plants, inspecting for pests, of course, roomy containers, interesting. That's interesting advice if you want something to flower. Usually it's the opposite. If you want a plant to flower, you keep it in a really tight pot so that it will feel like it's in danger or something like that. Provide for quick drainage, always good advice. Water generously. Yeah, probably for flowering things. I don't know. Keep air cool and humid. Give full sun. Keep foliage clean. So I guess full sun inside would probably be just a south-facing window or a west-facing window, but probably more south-facing window because the sun is like in those windows all day. The small home greenhouse. Oh, this is so sweet. I love this. Okay, I first of all love this photo. Like, I hope that this is me someday. This is a goal right here. Oh, she's so pretty, and I love all of these. These are so beautiful. These are not things that I would probably grow in my home greenhouse, but I love it nonetheless. So this basically tells you like tips on how to build a greenhouse and what you need. And so you would want it to be on the southern side of your house where it will get the most light. Morning sun is the most important and the sunshine after 4 p.m. standard time counts for little. So that is so true. That is why I really love east-facing windows because I think that is really like the best light your plants can get because the sun is really intense but it's not super hot yet. And if you live in the southern hemisphere, that would be a west-facing window. This is super, super nice. Okay. What else does it say? Okay, so we have terrariums. Ah, that terrarium is so pretty. Okay, so they describe a terrarium as a terrarium is a garden in a glass. And I think that is so sweet. You can keep plants green and glossy in the moist air inside with little watering. Possible containers for a glass garden are a fishbowl, clear glass cookie jar, or a gaslit globe like the one pictured here. I think that this a gaslit globe is so cool, and I'm interested. So where can I find one? In a terrarium, you can put African violets, baby tears, begonias, caladiums, crotons, English ivy, phytonia. Hey, phytonia. Ferns, peperomia, philodendron, whatever that word is. Moss, wandering Jew. Use the real name, Tranescantia. These are also plants that I feel like are not things that I would put in a terrarium. The last section of the houseplant chapter is succulents, which I'm interested to see what they have to say about succulents. Right here we have a jade plant, the Sedum arborescens, and this grows old beautifully, an easy succulent to grow. Like all of this group, jade plant needs sun, air, good soil, and little water. We love a plant that doesn't need a lot of water. Okay, so succulent plants, which grow wild in the desert, are so called because they are full of juicy tissue. This self-sufficiency helps them to exist with very little water. Not all succulents have spines, or are they prickly, as many people believe. The language in this book is so interesting because just this sentence alone, not all succulents have spines, or are they prickly? That's such a weird way to say they're not always prickly. It's just like the way that people used to write back in the day is just so interesting to me. Other good succulents are Kalanchoe, Sedum, Sempervivums, Spurges, Crassulus, and a bunch of others. We have Haworthia, Euphorbia. Most of the interest in these plants lies in their peculiar shapes, which vary from round and compact to spiky spirals. As houseplants, they lend themselves to unusual and beautiful arrangements. I love that. That's very nice. If you'd house a succulent group, you need look no further than your cupboard for a container. Groups of these plants are at home in roasting pans, cookie jars, or tin baking dishes. And as desert scenes or similar groups, they are more interesting than a row of little unrelated pots. I love that advice. That is basically advice that I give to plants like this. Just look so much better when they are potted together, because they are usually sold as smaller 2 to 4 inch plants, and they just look so much better when they are grouped together in a little scene. And you can see here, it looks like these are planted just like straight up in like sand, which I would not recommend at all. And I would also not recommend putting them in a baking dish because they need to be able to drain. But it's a sweet idea. I love the advice of putting them in a container together. Plantings should be made in a 2-inch soil depth. For soil mixture, use 2 parts sand with 1 part gardening loam. I don't know what gardening loam is. This allows air to reach the roots and avoid sogginess. Keep bases of the plants near the surface and don't crowd them too closely. Yeah, I guess that's pretty good advice. You definitely don't need like a thick layer of soil for these sorts of plants, because if they have too much soil, it'll hold moisture for too long, and that's not a good thing either. Since these are desert plants, they need only enough water to keep them plump looking. Never water when the soil looks moist. And in the summer, you can get double your money by putting your succulents outdoors and watching them. Many varieties produce beautiful blooms. I love that. Double your money, double the value. You can also put them outside and they do flower. That's a beautiful advice as well. So this grouping contains 6 common succulents, none of which cost more than 30 cents. Stop. 30 cents. What? I wonder if there's some sort of conversion to look back and see what 30 cents would be worth right now. It's probably about the same. Like as right now, like 30 cents is maybe like $5 or something like that. That is absolutely insane. So what we have here in this drawing, we have a plaid cactus, which is number 1 over here. 2, a moonshine. That looks like a jade or something like that. An autograph cactus, or the opuntia. I wonder why it's called an autograph cactus. Maybe because it's flat and maybe you can like write on it. I don't know. We have a silver torch, which I have, and it doesn't have branches like that. I don't think I've ever seen a silver torch have a branch like that. Maybe this is a different plant. Easter lily cactus. Not sure what that is. And then 6, we have a red pincushion, which is a mammillaria. Those are probably super common. That was really, really interesting. That is the end of the houseplant section, and now we have seed starting and propagation, which if you are interested in seeing me look through the seed starting and propagation, I would love to do that. If not, that's totally fine. I will just look at it myself. But it was kind of fun to read this together and look at it together. I actually really, really, really enjoyed myself during this video. It didn't even feel like I was doing this by myself. I feel like I was literally sitting with my friends reading this book together. I hope that you enjoyed seeing the inside of this Better Home and Gardens garden book. I know that I really enjoyed that, so if you enjoyed it too and you like what you saw here, make sure that you are subscribed to my channel so you don't miss future uploads, and give this video a like so that I know that you liked it, and I will see you guys in the next one. Bye!